Open up your Bibles, if you can, to Ecclesiastes chapter 3, Ecclesiastes chapter 3, and I want to continue our series on love as a verb. I want to talk to you today about love conquers. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11, here's what it says. Yet God has made everything beautiful for its own time. He has planted eternity in the human heart. I want you to get that today. He has planted eternity in the human heart. But even so, people cannot see the whole scope of God's work from beginning to end. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the spirit of revelation. Give our minds illumination that we would experience transformation. God, I pray you give us a mind to perceive, heart to receive all that you have. And I ask that after this message, we'll never be the same. In Jesus' name, and all God's people say, amen. Amen. You may be seated. If you don't have a message outline, our ushers would be more than happy to get you one. I believe that every one of us understands the importance of this weekend. It's the most attended weekend in church of any weekend in the year. It's because people have an understanding of it. And that is, we know that there's a God in heaven that sent his son Jesus to die for our sins, that Jesus died, he resurrected on the third day, and he built an amazing thing called the church. And one day, the church will be caught up with Jesus himself, for he will return as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You know, the thing is that we sit here and we go, well, yes, Pastor, Jesus died. And we can all sit here and agree that Jesus died to eradicate sin, to conquer it, get the keys of life and death, and give us the choice to accept him as Savior and have a relationship with God. But I think if you want to simplify it, it's very simple. Jesus died so that you can have the opportunity to know God. Not just know the God of the universe, but have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. The Bible says that when Jesus died, the veil torn. You see, in those days, the only person that was allowed to go to God on your behalf was a priest. But today, because that veil was torn, you and I can go boldly before Jesus. We can bring our petitions before him. We can call on him any time of the day, and he's right there with us. You can, the purpose of Jesus dying, listen, was so that you can know God. You can have this relationship with him. And this is what's awesome about it. And that is that God just doesn't want you to know him. But here's what happens when you get to know God, is that you begin to find freedom. You see, I can't tell you the day that I stopped drinking or I stopped using drugs. I was saved at 16. I gave my heart to Christ. But I can't tell you the day. All I can tell you is that when I gave my heart to Christ, I did everything I can to get to know God more. I started to discover things about God, the way he thought about me. I heard all my life God was mad at me. People told me you can't go to church because the way you dress, the way you look, you're from the streets, you do all these type of things. And all those things became real thoughts in my mind that kept me away from church. But as I began to come to church, when I got saved, I began to read my Bible. I began to know about God and get to know what he knew about me. I found out that God loves me. I found out that God is for me and not against me. I found out that his grace never runs out. I found out that his mercies are new every morning. I found out that if I call on the name of the Lord, he will save my life. I found out that I don't have to live bound. I don't have to live in my past. I don't need to live with guilt. I don't need to live with shame. No, I found out that he says there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. I found out those things. And friends, can I tell you that as I began to know God and I began to find out who he was, listen, I began to live in freedom. I began to live free from my past. I began to live free from the mistakes that I made. I began to live free from the shame and the guilt. See, I didn't need someone to lay hands on me, get some goosebumps, do whatever. No, no. It was just a daily process. I have this personal relationship with him. I get to know who God is. And as I began to know God, listen, I began to find freedom. See, that's why Jesus died. He died so that we can have this personal relationship with Jesus, that we can find freedom. Because it's one thing to get set free. It's another thing to stay free. We can come to church, have an amazing service. I believe during Spiritual Renewal Week, people are going to be set free. But guess what? As you walk with Jesus every day in this personal relationship with him, listen, you live in freedom every day. I get to live. And you know what, friends? It wasn't like, you know, hocus pocus, everything changed. No, it was one step at a time. One moment at a time, I began to live free. Man, things would come up. It wouldn't bother me no more. I'd look back and go, man, why didn't that bother me? And I realized, because I'm living in freedom now. See, friends, listen, you and I get to know God. But the real question is why did Jesus resurrect? What was the purpose of him resurrecting? You know, Jesus came back so that you and I can discover our purpose. We could find the reason, the why behind why we're alive today. One of the greatest tragedies about people is that they live without ever knowing why they were called to live. They never discovered their purpose. But I think within every single one of us, it's not just trying to discover our purpose, but I believe Jesus came back. I believe he resurrected, not for you to just discover your purpose, but watch this, for you to make a difference in life. You know, I struggle to believe that people wake up every morning and are like, oh, well, you know what, man, I'm just gonna live mediocre today. I struggle to believe that people just get up and go, well, you know what, man? I mean, you know, I'm just going to barely get by today. I struggle that people live with those thoughts. Why? Because within every single one of us, there's something inside of us that says, I want to make a difference. I want to make a difference in my children's life. I want to make a difference in my career. I want to make a difference in my family. I want to make a difference in my community. I believe it's inside of us. And God is the one that placed that desire in every one of us. And so, hey, he died so that, watch this, I can know God. I can find freedom. I can stay free. But he came back. He rose from the grave so I can discover my purpose. And listen, I can make a difference in the lives of people. You see, there's a story in Luke 24 that really talks about when Jesus came back. The Bible says, but very early on Sunday morning, you had to be at the 7 o'clock service to say amen to that one, okay? But very early on Sunday morning, the women went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. I wanna stop right there for really quick because that's a cultural thing. And in those days, the culture was that when someone died, they would go through a embalming process. And you would have to bring these spices, and they would get some oil, they'd pour the spices on the linen, and they would wrap the dead body in that linen, and that's what they did. So I want you to see, because this story from a cultural content is telling us the mindset of these people who went to the tomb. They went with their spices, which they believed he was there and he was dead. That's what they believed. So here they are. They're going to the tomb. They have the spices prepared. They found that the stone had been rolled away from the entrance. And so they went in, but they didn't find the body. Now, that could be a little weird, okay? We know he's there, but man, we have our spices. We're ready to balm him. But guess what? They stood there puzzled. Two men suddenly appeared to them, clothes in dazzling robes. The women were terrified. Can you imagine? Who are you? What are you? And they bowed their faces to the ground because they realized this was more than just a human that was speaking. And the men asked, why are you looking among the dead for someone who is alive? He isn't here. He's risen from the dead. Now, I want you to get this. Watch what they say. Remember what he told you back in Galilee. In other words, this shouldn't be a shock to you because I have been telling you this. He has been telling you that he's gonna die, he's gonna resurrect, so you shouldn't be in shock. But they were, because here it is, that the Son of Man must be betrayed into the hands of a sinful man and crucified, and that he would rise again on the third day. It goes on to say this in Luke 24. It says, then they remembered, and they said this. So watch this. So they rushed back from the tomb to tell the 11 disciples and everyone else what had happened. They're like, he's not there. This is incredible. He's not there. But when they get to the disciples, these are the men that had been with them for 3.5 years. Look what happens. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and several other women who told the apostles what had happened. So they're telling them, we took our spices. We knew he was dead. We got there. He's not there. These angels appeared to us. They spoke to us. And they're telling, and look what it says. But the story sounded like nonsense. To the men. So they didn't believe it. Here's what's amazing. These men had been with him for 3.5 years. They saw him take 2 fish and 5 loaves with their own eyes and feed the multitudes. They saw him come to Lazarus' tomb when he had been dead for 4 days. His friend, when the people were weeping, and he spoke, and Lazarus came walking out. They saw him with a blind man open his eyes, a deaf man open his ears. They were there when they saw that the men were trying to get through the front door, but they couldn't get to because the house was full. So they dug a hole in the top of the roof, and they laid down a paralytic man. And they saw this man leap from his bed and be healed. They saw it with their own eyes. But yet, the whole time, he was telling them, guys, I'm leaving. I'm going to die, but I'm going to come back. And when that time came, when that moment came, when the rubber hit the road, here's what happened. They didn't believe. They doubted. See, if I can turn this entire auditorium and overflow to overflow and make it into a living room, let me be transparent with you. I know what that's like. I know what it's like to love God, to serve God, and sometimes still doubt. You know, when my mother died at 51, she had a clean bill of health 2 weeks prior, and the Lord took her. You don't think there was some doubt in my life at that time? Man, my brother, who was diagnosed with cystic fibrosis at the age of 7, the doctor said he won't live past 11. He was 1 hour away from a lung transplant. I was at USC Medical Center. He was at Long Beach Memorial Hospital. I was waiting for the donors to go in there and give up one of their lobes. I get a phone call. You better get to Long Beach Memorial. Your brother's organs are failing. I didn't make it in time. While I was driving down the 110 freeway to catch the 405 into Long Beach, you don't think there was doubt going on in my life? When my sister, who God miraculously healed of lupus, no more dialysis, almost gave her a brand new kidney, goes to Bible college, graduates, getting ready to travel the world to share her story. She has a massive brain hemorrhage. She dies at the age of 30. During this time, I was traveling the world, speaking to large crowds. People were getting saved. I'd go back into my hotel room. I'd cry. God, you're saving so many. Sometimes I wonder if you're even there. And I think at times, I didn't share it. And I'll tell you why I didn't share it. Because, man, if I would have shared, man, I got some doubts. People would have told me things like, you need to pray more. You need to have more faith. And at that time, I didn't want to hear it. The bottom line is that every one of us goes through seasons in our lives where we have some doubts, where things happen in our life. It doesn't mean you don't love God. It doesn't mean that you're not serving him. It just means that you're human and you go through emotions at times. But here's the problem. The problem is that when we go through things like that, we run away from church when we should be running to church, because we can be reassured that God is there for our lives. Listen, there were times when I would be in church and I would want to worship, but I didn't feel like it. But I realized worship has nothing to do with feelings, has everything to do with facts, that he is God, he loves me, he's worthy to be praised. And let me tell you something, I learned that the thing that I can do when I go through seasons of doubt is to be in the house of God, to come to church, to realize that I can be, my faith can be reaffirmed. My faith can be strengthened. You know, you want to know why you're here today? It's very simple. You believe that Jesus died. You're here today because you believe that Jesus resurrected. You believe that. But the question is what keeps you away all these other weekends, all these other Wednesday nights? What keeps you away from that? It's simple. You doubt. Sometimes you doubt your life. Sometimes you doubt that God has this dynamic future for your life. And friends, that's what the enemy wants. The enemy of your soul wants to keep you away so that you're not reassured of the future God has for your life. You're not reassured about the fact that God has a better future than your past. He doesn't want you to be reassured that, you know what? God loves you and he's not against you. He wants you to be reassured of those things. And the thing is that this is why. Imagine if Jesus just would have died. Imagine if he would have just stood in the tomb. He would have had some guys that he invested 3.5 years of his life in that saw all these miracles take place. Friends, they would have remained hiding in that room. They would have been scared of their lives. They would have lived the rest of their lives with this doubt, even though in some sense they believed. You want to know why Jesus came back? You want to know why Jesus continues to make his way back to you? Because he wants to eradicate that doubt. He wants you to come to the full assurance that, man, he has a plan for your life. See, what happens when Jesus, what's the purpose of Jesus returning? Is that, man, number A, he wants to walk with you. This is what he's about. Look what the Bible says. The Bible says this. It continues, the story in Luke 24. It says, that same day, two of Jesus' followers were walking in the village on the road to Emmaus, 7 miles from Jerusalem. And as they walked along, they were talking about everything that happened. So they were talking about the tomb is empty, he's not there. And as they talked and discussed these things, here it is, Jesus himself suddenly came and began walking with them. In other words, he got in their Kool-Aid, figured out the flavor, all that kind of stuff. And so I want you to see this. Here they are. They just heard all these news. OMG, hashtag, he's not there. He's not in the tomb. I mean, where did he go? Did the disciples steal him at night? And they're having this conversation, and Jesus kind of like swoops up like right into their conversation. He's like walking with them. They don't even know he's there. And he's like eavesdropping into their conversation. He's listening. But here's what's amazing. He's walking with them one step at a time. And the whole time he's walking with them, they're confused. They're doubting. Don't ever think that Jesus isn't walking with you because you're doubting. No, let me tell you something. He is interested in those conversations. You know those conversations when you're driving all by yourself and no one's around? Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, nobody's around, and you have these doubts in your mind. Can I tell you? He sweeps right in and he goes along with those conversations with you. Can I tell you that when it's late at night, nobody's around, and all of a sudden you're doubting what's going to happen tomorrow? Can I tell you? He swoops right into your bed. He's right there with you. Why? Because Jesus is interested in listening to your doubts. But you got to get this. He's interested in listening to your doubts, but he doesn't agree with them. He'll listen to them, but man, he'll give you a promise for that doubt that you have in your life. I'm so glad that I serve a Savior that's willing to walk with me even when I go through seasons of doubt. He's listening. I thank God that I serve a Savior that's not shoving him down. You know, my mother told me when I first got saved, you know, I was one of those zealous guys, 16. I was radical saved. And I said, Mom, I want to preach to everybody. So I got a bullhorn. I went on a street corner. I only did it for a week. That's it. Don't hate me, right? And now you're going to go to hell. You need Jesus, all this kind of stuff. Blah, 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 all this kind of, now I can't stand that. But yeah, you're going to do that, right? And I came home one day, mom goes, son, what were you doing? I said, mom, I was telling everybody about Jesus. I was on the street corner. She goes, mijo, you can't do that. And I said, okay, mom. And she says, son, listen, if I stuck a stake down your throat, you would choke and die. She goes, you can't shove Jesus down people's throat. You got to give them a piece at a time. Because when it's all said and done, friends, when they just get a piece, it tastes different. And then all of a sudden, they want another piece. And then they taste it. It starts tasting a little good, and then they get another piece. Come on, you know what you're talking about, a good old steak, right? And you're like, yeah. Then all of a sudden, you're like, I mean, you like it now. You're like trying to, and then how much you like it is after you sucking that little beef out your teeth. You know, you trying to get the last final taste. But here it is. If you shoved it down someone's throat, you want to know what the church has done for so many years? It's Jesus or the highway. But you know what destiny you know we're about? Take one piece at a time. Come on, eventually you'll acquire the taste. Eventually you'll realize this is a good thing. God is a good thing. And you want to know what? You're not going to choke and die. You're going to be leaving destiny after a few weeks, sucking them teeth, going, oh, that sermon was good. Oh, the music was good. Oh, my life is doing better. Oh, it's good right now. I can't wait to come back. I can't wait to get here. Because it's the way God does. He's willing to walk with you. Not only is he willing to walk with you, listen, he came back because he's willing to talk with you. Look what the Bible says. The Bible goes on to say this. It continues, says, and he asked them. I mean, can you imagine Jesus? He's walking with them, and these two guys are like, you know, talking all kinds of smack and stuff, and they're doubting, and like he just like swoops up in their conversation, and then he just goes, hey, he asked them, what are you guys discussing so intently as you walk along? So if Jesus is talking like that, this, you know when you have that intense conversation where you like your veins pop out, you know what I mean, and stuff, you're like madly staring at each other. And so he's saying like, man, you guys are really into this. And they stop short, sadness written across their faces, as the Bible says, which means their face really tells their story. They're doubting. Then one of them, Cleopas, replied, and here's what he said. I love this. You must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all the things that have happened there the last few days. And then look at Jesus' response. Like I'm right here, guys. Look at his response. He goes, what things? What things? And I mean, at that moment, they probably like, boy, you are either ignorant, you are out of the time, you're not on social media, you need to get yourself on Facebook, all this kind of stuff. I mean, he's probably sitting there and they said, the things, watch this, the things that happened to Jesus. You know that man from Nazareth, they said he was a prophet who did powerful miracles and he was a mighty teacher in the eyes of God and all the people. And you know, and they don't even realize it's him. They're talking about him and he's right there. I've had moments, man, God, I wish you'd have healed my sister. He was right there. God, why am I having this bad day? I don't deserve this. He's right there. God, why? I worked so hard in this career and they just kind of let me go. What's next? He's right there. He's listening. He's talking to you, and he's willing to find out, to get to the core of what's driving this whole thing in your life. He's willing to get there. There's nothing like having a conversation with people who immediately are not trying to give you an answer. My mother said it the best. She says, son, what do you think God wants you to do? He gave you two ears and one mouth. Listen before you speak. And I love talking to people that they will hear me out and not stop me and go, well, here's the answer. Let me give you the answer. I mean, it's almost like most of us who talk it out will realize what the answer is. But it's so good to talk to people who are not trying to shove an answer or their own biasness, but they're just willing to listen. even when we're wrong. I can't tell you. I have conversations like that. I'm at my house. I'm walking back. I can't believe. And my wife's just listening, smiling. Her blonde hair, well, it's red now, blonde. And she's like, you know, and I mean, and she's just listening to me. And I'm like, okay, like I just talked for 30 minutes. You can give me an answer now. She goes, oh, no, you know, you're good. He's willing to walk with you. He's willing to talk to you. And here's why. To prove to you who he is. To prove to you who he is. You know, the Bible goes on. The story continues. And look what Jesus did. Look, this is the Savior of the world. Look what he did. And here's what the Bible says. He's not a respecter of people, which means if he did it for them, he'll do it for you. And look what he did. Look what he said. He says, then Jesus took them through the writings of Moses and all the prophets. Here it is, explaining from all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Friends, God doesn't want you to walk out confused. Nobody wants you to be confused about their life. He wants to show you who he is. He wants to reveal to you who he is. Man, when you come to church on Sundays, you come to church, man, listen, you know what God does? He's just allowing himself to be explained to you. It's why you walk away from Sundays going, wow, this is what he really knows about. This is what really he's going to do in my life. Wow, this is what he has for my marriage. Wow, this is what he has for my career. Wow, this is what he has for my relationship. But imagine those times when you allow those doubts to drive you away from the house of God, only to bring you back and allow him to explain himself. I look at it every Sunday that God has a way of explaining himself to you. I look at it on Wednesdays. God has a way of explaining himself to you. And the more God explains himself to you, the more you get to know him. The more you get to know him, the more you find freedom. The more you find freedom, the sooner you discover your purpose. The sooner you discover your purpose, the sooner you begin to make a difference in the lives of people. You see, he said it. I planted eternity in your hearts. In other words, we shouldn't live and be so caught up in what's going on now. This world is broken. Our government system is broken. The nations of the world are broken. They have to be. Because the only thing that will be whole will be the bride, which is the church of Jesus Christ. And let me tell you something. We can sit there and go, oh, man, they're going to make it better. Oh, no, friends. The Bible tells us how the end times look like. And if you don't think we're living in the end times, take a good look. We're living in the end times, which means Jesus is coming back again. We can be the only generation that can sit there and say, we've seen prophecy fulfilled, prophecy unveiled, and yet at any given time, Jesus can come back. And what we got to do as a bride, we got to prepare ourselves. Right. Yesterday, we had a few weddings, and I was talking after prayer meeting. I was talking to a couple of the guys that were here setting up. I was talking to one of the girls and I always asked them, you know, how's the bride doing? Oh, she was up early. She had her breakfast. You know, she's getting her makeup done. Oh, but how has it been the last couple of months? Oh, it's been stressful. But man, she's had to prepare herself for this day. Isn't it amazing that it's natural for a bride to prepare themselves for that day that she's going to see the groom? Can I tell you, that's the way we should be living all the time. Our groom, Jesus Christ, is coming back for us. We ought to live every day preparing ourselves for come, Lord Jesus, come. Come on, you're going to change our lives, and we're going to live eternity with you. See, Titus talked about it. He said in Titus chapter 2, he says, for the grace of God has been revealed, bringing salvation to all people, and we are instructed to turn from godless living and sinful pleasures. We should live in this evil world with what? With wisdom, with righteousness, and devotion to God. And so while we look forward with hope to what wonderful day when the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, will be what? Revealed. We ought to be waiting for that. Why do you think We wrote this for you because it just gives you something every day for the next 14 days. I'm going to have my devotion to God, which means more devotion to God, less devotion to the past, to the things in your life. The closer I get to God, the more freedom I get to receive. The closer I get to discover my purpose and then soon begin to make a difference. Come on, how many know we did it for your kids too? So your kids can have a devotional life with God so they don't have to make the mistakes. My kids don't have to make the mistakes that I made. They can be kids. They can learn to love God, stay with God, live with God, and do all kinds of things with God. Come on, that's what it should be about. Because here's what it is. Jesus offers more than a better now. You may, my life is great. No. He offers more than a better now because he offers a better place. The place where you and I will spend eternity. He says, listen, this is going to be a better place for all of us. It's not just now. Oh, these things, they'll come and go. So you, Pastor Obed, what do I need to do? Well, the first thing you need to do is you need to refocus your energies. You need to refocus your energies. Look what the Bible says. The Bible says this. It says, so we don't look at the troubles we can see now, be moved by them. Oh, my God, my life is worse. No, your life ain't bad. We fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. He says, man, refocus your life. Stop seeing that everything's coming against you. Stop thinking that, man, you're never going to make it. Stop looking at what's now. No, just start looking at what's ahead in your life. One of our couples, our girl that was here the last service, sitting in the front row. You know, she, a few years ago, had to make a decision in her life. Husband wasn't doing that great, and she landed up having to make a decision, just, hey, I gotta live for my kids. And she landed up checking into our Bible college. God began to do something in her, but in the midst of all of that, she lost her business. It was an air conditioning business. She lost it, little small business. Well, she kept on going, serving the Lord. She landed up meeting this one guy. Met this guy. He's in the air conditioning business, making great money back in Riverside. They landed up getting married. They stayed here. He would drive every day to Corona and back just to make sure food was on their table. Had a phenomenal job. They decided a year and a half ago, man, let's not do that drive. They moved to Corona, stood out there for about 6 months, and then next thing you know, they moved back. She'd been asking God, what do you have for my life? And not knowing that she was going to come full circle, that through a relationship, an opportunity came, and they were able to buy a company, an air conditioning company, but not an air conditioning company that she lost that was this small. An air conditioning that they bought that's this big. You say, Pastor Obed, what does that mean? It means this. It means, man, when you refocus your energy and you stop walking around, woe is me, man, nothing's getting better, the things are just getting worse. No, friends. You will get what you see and you will get what you say. If you start seeing the way God sees, you start saying the things God says, I promise you God will change your situation around. And let me tell you something, he will bless your life like never before in Jesus' name. It's exactly what he will do. But it's up to you. You got to be the one that refocuses my energy. The Bible says in Matthew 6, it says, don't store up treasures here on earth where moths eat them and rust destroys them, where thieves break in and steal. No, store your treasures in heaven. Make your investment in heavenly things. What does that mean? In my devotional life, in my prayer life, man, coming to church, you know, giving my heart to God. That's where I'm going to make my investment in. Why? Because every time I do, that investment brings me a phenomenal return in my life. The second thing I got to do is I got to reason in my heart. You got to reason in your own heart. What do I have to reason? Here's what the Bible says. The Bible says this, the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. And just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, here it is, he will give you life to your mortal bodies, this same Spirit living inside of you. If God's Holy Spirit is living inside of you, you may call it dead, But the same resurrection power lives inside of you. God can resurrect things that the enemy stole in your life. He can resurrect things in your life that, you know what, you thought were done and gone. Just like that girl who thought, man, my air conditioning business is over with. That career I'll never have. What did God do? He resurrected it. And not only did he resurrect it, he returned 100-fold back to them. Friends, don't tell me we don't serve an awesome God. And see, you got to sit there and reason in your heart. You got to move to what you believe. Man, I believe that he is Jesus. I believe that he has the best for my life. I believe that, man, God loves me. It's just one step at a time. You know, I'll never forget when I was hooked on drugs and alcohol. I was raised in church, and so I knew the things of church. But every night before I'd go to bed, for whatever reason, I would pray this prayer. Lord, don't come back tonight, because I'm not ready. And I really believe he saw my honesty. He saw my doubts. He saw the fact that I was struggling. And I believe that's why he sent people my way, to invite me to come to church, to get involved in church. I believe that when my life got changed, he put people in my life, in my church, that would call me, that would be there for me. Because friends, what it is that it's a step. We can't just expect you're just gonna change overnight. No, don't allow your disappointments. Listen, don't allow your disappointments to rob you from your divine appointments. God has divine appointments for your life. He has people that he's already prepared. They're going to come down your path. He's brought you here today so that you can get just a little bit more hope to sit there and say, I'll take one more step. I'll just take one more step. And friends, the more you come, the more you sit there and you decide, I'm going to make him a priority in our lives. I have eternity in my heart. I want to make sure I spend it with him. I promise you, God will just continue to unfold the blessings that he has for your life. Man, if you would have told me 13 years ago, if you see the number 12, we're celebrating our 12 years as a church, but if you would have told me 13 years ago that Lissette and I would move to the desert, we wouldn't know a lot of people, we'd start in a living room with seven people, and now we are growing to multiple campuses, if you'd have told me that, I'd have said, oh no, I ain't going to the desert. They don't got no malls. They only got one mall, and it was boring at that time. I lived in the South Bay. Man, you had five malls. If they didn't have it at one gap, you could drive 15 minutes, go to another one. They didn't have it there. You can drive down to, you can go to Orange County, go to South Coast Plaza. I mean, you had all kinds of places where you could shop. Over here, we got. And so, if you'd have told me that, 13 years, you're going to move to the desert, I'd be like, oh, the devil is a lie, right? If you would have told me last year that the church we came from, 1,500 people, 29 properties, a school with from preschool all the way to 12th grade, that Lissette and I would be the next pastors of that place, and it would be an extension, it would be another campus of Destiny Church, I'd have told you, you're crazy. Friends, if God would have showed it all at one time, I'd have said, Lord, I can't do that. But because you just keep on taking one step at a time, he begins to show you things. And as you continue to take that step, man, I want to own a business one day. Take that step. Come on. He'll give you that confidence. He'll build it up inside of you. And what you doubted yourself a few years ago, now you have the confidence to do it. Man, I want to go back to school. I want to further my career. What seemed impossible 3 years now seems tangible. Why? Because you've just been taking one step at a time. My friends, listen, God ain't here to scare you, but if he showed you your future, here's what he says about your future. Your future's filled with hope. Here's what he says about your future. Man, no eyes have seen, no ears has heard all that I have in store for your life. That's what he's telling you about your future. And this is why you just got to trust him one step at a time and just sit there and say, okay, God. But here's the problem. Doubt will cause you to go Michael Jackson. Seriously, you'll start moonwalking backwards. And this is why so many of us start off so great on Easter and end so poorly at the end of the year. And our lives just look like a cycle. It just looks like we're just at the same place, but it's just a different year and a different time. You want to know why? Because you've allowed doubt to drive you back instead of allowing it to just say, nope, I know that he's here with me. I know that he talks to me. I know he won't leave me. No, he'll never forsake me. I'm going to take another step. And sometimes, friends, that step is hard. It's hard to take those steps sometimes. But you know what? You buckle your seatbelt. You know you got a dynamic future ahead of your life. And you say, the worst is behind me and the best is ahead of me. And I'm going to take that step one more time in Jesus' name. That's the kind of God we serve. He's an awesome God. He's a magnificent God. He's an amazing God. That's the kind of God that absolutely loves you, and he loves me. And this is what he wants to do. He just wants you, listen, as I close, this is what he wants you to do. It's simple. Renew a relationship with him. It's not hard. Come on. You know what it's like to break up with somebody and then go, okay, we'll get back together. Here's the thing. Oftentimes when that happens, it just continues to get worse. But with God, nothing gets worse because we're the ones that break up with him. He's always the one that's waiting just for you to come around and say, man, would you give your life back to me? See, 2 Peter says, but we're looking forward to the new heavens and the new earth that he's promised, a world filled with God's righteousness. Watch this. And so, dear friends, while you are waiting for these things to happen, make every effort to be found living peaceful lives that you may live pure and blameless in his sight. Here's what he's saying. Just take a step with me. That's all it is. You came this Sunday. Why would it be hard to come next Sunday? Why would it be hard for you to get baptized? Well, if you've given your life to Jesus, oh, well, Pastor Obed, I got baptized as a Catholic. No, that doesn't happen. Your priest will tell you that. No one gets baptized in Christianity, Catholic. We're all baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We just don't mix locations with how you're baptized, okay? But you know what's crazy? I was studying this weekend, and I was kind of rabbit trailing a little bit, and I just... had this thought in my mind, like, how long am I going to live? You know, we've had some deaths this week, and this valley came together for one precious little child. We've had some deaths in our own church. So it hit home to me. What? How long am I going to live? I wanted to know. You know, I found a report that says females will live to 81. Men live to 86, I mean to 76. I thought, man, that's not a lot. But you know, our life is that way. Because God, what he does is that he gives us this opportunity. See, this is how long I'm gonna live. You and I, this is a lifespan he gives us. And here's what's amazing. This is eternity. It's endless. But how you decide your eternity and where you'll spend it is by this span of life that he gives you. Listen, you're not going to have a chance when it's done because there is eternity. And not only is there eternity, he put it in your heart. So eternity already is inside of you. You got to make the choice. Not only you got to make the choice, you got to believe. See, if you believe in Jesus, earth is as close to hell as you'll ever get. It only gets better. But if you don't believe in Jesus yet, earth is as close to heaven as you'll ever get. It's just going to get worse. See, I decided I'm going to live not for this, but I'm going to live for this. Because can I tell you something? Any wise person won't invest in this more than they'll invest in that. Because this is forever. This is temporary. Here's what he wants: a personal relationship. Here's what he wants: for you to know him, so you can find freedom, so you can discover your purpose. Listen, so you can make a difference.